What are the best new red cards out of Core 2021? Stay tuned and I'll tell you. Welcome to this video series. This is a collaboration with the Oathbreaker Thoughtcast. In this episode, we're looking at the 10 best new red cards for your Oathbreaker decks out of Core Set 2021. I make Magic the Gathering and Oathbreaker content, and if that's what you're into, don't forget to like, share, and subscribe to the channel. This is your host, Chad here. I will be paraphrasing Alex Ender's article. If you want to read the full article, I'll put a link in the description. Another MTG preview season has come and gone, which means it's time for me to do my top 10 series for Core 2021 cards in Oathbreaker. My top 10s are based on 1. How strong I think the card will be in Oathbreaker, and 2. How many different types of Oathbreaker decks I expect to see the card played in. While I do try to be as objective as I can, these are ultimately just my own thoughts and opinions. With all that out of the way, let's continue with my top 10 red cards from Core 2021 for Oathbreaker. Number 10, Unleash Fury. Unleash Fury reminds me a lot of Temur Battle Rage, both in cost and function. Doubling a creature's power is, generally speaking, not as helpful as giving a double strike and trample, but this kind of pump spell does have its advantages. Cards like Ram Through and Domari's Ambush both benefit greatly from power buffs, and creatures like Krenko, Tin Street Kingpin, are excellent targets for this type of spell. In addition to general stompy strategies, this kind of pump spell would fit very well into a heroic or prowess-themed deck, most likely somewhere in the 58 rather than as the signature spell. Also, both this card's art and flavor text are... I find this card insane. If you add Double Strike to the mix with this card, it has a potential to one-shot a player out of the game, especially if it has Infect in the deck. Well, that's just a thought that worries me just a bit. Number 9, Conspicuous Snoop. I couldn't justify giving Conspicuous Snoop a higher spot on this list since it's pretty exclusively playable in Goblin Tribal strategies, but it is a very strong addition to this particular archetype. A future sight for goblins, stapled to a goblin nonetheless, for only 2 mana can provide these typically aggressive strategies with some very handy card advantage, especially since you can even cast non-creature goblin spells off with this ability. There's also a relatively high number of goblins with relevant activated abilities such as Palish Mons, Cirque Prospector, and Krenko, Mob Boss, just to name a few. Conspicuous Snoop even has a bit of combo potential when paired with good old Kiki Jiki Mirror Breaker. I myself have a Black-Red Goblin Tribal Oathbreaker deck, and I greatly look forward to finding room in it for this new friend. If a Black-Red Goblin Tribal deck is the way you want to go, try out Ingrath, Captain of Chaos. Having a huge army of menacing goblins is nice, but if you want to stay on theme, then Duretti, Ingenious Iconoclast, is a goblin, but not the best choice. Number 8, Subira Tolzuti Caravaneer. Subira Tolzuti Caravaneer is a new legend that is very reminiscent of Breakthrough the Line, and it is similarly well suited to low to the ground, go wide aggressive decks. On top of being able to help force through combat damage, Subira can turn a go wide offense into some strong red card advantage. It's a bit unfortunate that the last ability doesn't also count combat damage against planeswalkers, but that isn't that big of a downside. After all, player removal is technically also planeswalker removal. I also like how Subira's first activated ability can be used politically by targeting opposing creatures, an option that would come in handy when teaming up against an opponent. Overall, I don't think Subira Tolzuti Caravaneer will be making too big of a wave in Oathbreaker, but it is a solid new addition to a fair number of go-wide strategies. She is well suited to many strategies, and this card is a rare worth watching. Number 7, Chandra's Pyroling. Fittingly enough, Chandra's Pyroling is similarly templated to Chandra's Spitfire. with the latter being a tad more aggressive. Even still, this fiery little two-drop can become a serious threat very quickly, especially when paired with an Oathbreaker that can deal non-combat damage. The double strike granted by this ability also pairs well with any other additional power buffs, meaning you may only have to trigger this ability once in certain situations. The field of deck types this type of card can be slotted into is still fairly slim, but I am sure Chandra's Pyreling will prove to be a powerhouse in decks built to support this type of effect. This little bugger will find its way into any Chandra deck pretty easily, but in a creature-focused strategy, it may have some trouble triggering the bonus power and damage, so give it a thought before adding it to your decks. It isn't an auto-include at all. Number 6, Gadrak the Crown Scourge. Gadrak the Crown Scourge is a very low-cost threat that comes with an interesting restriction. A 5/4 flyer for 3 mana is obviously a ridiculous rate for a creature, so it's no wonder that his offensive capability is somewhat limited. Fortunately enough, Gadrak also comes with a way of circumventing this restriction. And most artifact-based red decks won't even need the help to keep at least 4 artifacts in play. It's also worth noting that Gadrak can still block if you don't have 4 or more artifacts, and his final ability counts all non-token creatures that died this turn, including your opponents. I suspect Gadrak will ultimately only see play in dedicated Artifact Matters decks, but he'll be a very powerful new addition to that archetype. I don't fully agree with that statement, as even in a non-artifact-based deck, this is a source of ramp in red and could be help for many Boros and red strategies. I, for one, am kicking around a Sarkhan the Masterless / Dragonstorm deck based around this gentleman. Number 5, Transmogrify. Everyone say hello to the Red Polymorph. Red has received similar cards in the past, such as Reality Scramble, but this particular sorcery is almost word for word the same as good old Polymorph. Divergent Transformation and Indomitable Creativity are two similar red spells that currently see a little bit of play as signature spells, and I suspect most players will still default to those two options over this new card. Even still, Transmogrify is a welcome addition to the list of redundant Polymorph enablers, and I'm sure it'll turn games on their head whether it's in the 58 or in the command zone. Cards like this are straight up shenanigans. They're a great way to get a deck's hidden commander into play or to pull a monster out of nowhere. Number 4, Chandra Heart of Fire. This newest iteration of Chandra has an interesting mixture of abilities and, like most previous versions of Chandra, is clearly pretty geared towards burn strategies. The second plus one ability can be a nice way to peck away at opponents' life totals or keep an imposing Oathbreaker in check, but I'm more interested in the first plus one ability. In an aggressive burn deck that's already looking to empty its hand as soon as possible, Chandra's first plus one ability is almost as powerful as drawing 3 cards. The effect even uses the word play, meaning that you can play lands off of this ability as well as cast spells. The only part of this card that puts me off a little is the mana cost of 5, but I suspect this card will be well worth the cost in the right deck, especially since it comes in with a whopping 5 loyalty. I agree with Alex here. Generally, 5 and 6 mana planeswalkers are hard to run in colors outside of green or don't have green's mana support, so it will be interesting to see how people circumvent that to make this a playable Oathbreaker. Number 3, Volcanic Salvo. At first glance, Volcanic Salvo seems like a win more card. After all, if you already have 10 power on the board, shouldn't you already be ahead? I can certainly understand why some players would consider this a win more card, but that's not actually how I view the card. In my experience, creature planeswalker interaction can be very handy even if you already have a substantial board presence. I run Domari's Ambush as my Gruul Stompy signature spell of choice for this very reason, and Volcanic Salvo has the potential to be even more devastating. In addition to traditional Stompy decks, I suspect Volcanic Salvo could see play in almost any creature-heavy strategy. This spicy sorcery also may have what it takes to become a popular signature spell, since its cost reduction effect can also help you get around commander tax, similar to cards like Thoughtcast. Perhaps I'm a bit biased by my excitement to jam this card into Stompy decks, but I suspect this card could become a new staple in red creature-heavy strategies. It seems like a natural little brother to cards like Blasphemous Act, and I will be interested to see how people build around it. Number 2, Chandra's Incinerator. If this card didn't come with a cost reduction effect, it likely still would have made it onto this list somewhere. Chandra's Incinerator is a 6-drop that never actually is going to cost 6 mana in the decks that want to run this massive elemental. On top of being able to trample through any blockers, this card passively turns all of the bum spells and abilities you point at your opponent's faces into removal spells. Not having to choose between bolting an opponent and bolting an Oathbreaker can be a huge boon to a burn deck, especially ones that are already lacking in card advantage department. Aggressive strategies that primarily rely on combat damage will probably want to stay away from this card, but decks that rely more on burn effects are going to absolutely love playing this powerhouse. Number 1, Terror of the Peaks. Dragon is one of my favorite creature types, and Terror of the Peaks seems like a very efficiently cost dragon for 5 mana. You're essentially getting a Warstorm Surge with wings, and if that wasn't good enough for you, it even punishes any opponent that tries to target it. This damage tax effect somewhat makes up for the fact that Terror of the Peaks doesn't come with haste. But then again, red also has no shortage of haste enablers in its arsenal anyways. Even though Terror of the Peaks will typically be at its best in creature-heavy strategies, this card's abilities don't restrict it to any particular type of deck. This dragon is the type of threat that can be played in a large variety of deck archetypes, and I'm really looking forward to trying out Terror of the Peaks in a whole slew of Oathbreaker lists. What are your favorite red cards from Core 2021? Are there any red cards you're particularly excited to try out in Oathbreaker? Make sure you tell me in the comments or on Twitter, and I'll be back with the top 10 green cards from Core 2021 for Oathbreaker. Check out our deck tech playlist here on the end card or a YouTube suggested video here. And thanks again. I hope you enjoyed spending time with me and the Oathbreaker Thoughtcast.